in Oregon election.
Supporting that is an informal skateboarding park built and paid for by the skateboarders themselves. It's here under the Burnside Bridge on the east side. Police say the park's actually cleaned up the neighborhood a little bit. There's been a decrease in vandalism and illegal drug use in that area. The mayor's office will administer the site. The skateboarders themselves will maintain it. Mark Scott's been working on this project for almost 2 years. He says the resolution's nice, but he wants even more.
I'd like to get it so that it could be a national monument or something, so it'd stay here forever. But that's just, I'm probably dreaming there, but, you know, I just like building and I like skating, and this is the place to do it for me.
How you doing? Working hard?
Come on now, redneck.
Give us your full name.
Mark Scott.
How'd you get the name Red?
Well, you're talking southern accent from Oregon, man. That don't make sense to me, man. I'm just joking around. It's coming redneck. I don't get it. Come on now.
Red and I met through skating, as we met everybody in high school. And, you know, we were from the city of Portland, and he was from what we considered the sticks of Tigard. And so we called him Redneck.
Boundary, my ass!
So we knew Red as this crazy maniac skate dude, you know, and then we end up at his house to skate his ramp, and we're looking, we're like, dude, this guy's from, like, not conservative, but just totally normal suburban upbringing.
My mom and dad were great, just working class people that definitely weren't hippies.
His dad is, you know, good, solid blue collar cat.
He was a carpenter for many years when I was younger. He had the hammer nails, and he'd bring me some wood, and just like, there you go, kids. Like, that's all I need. At one point, I had like 10 tree houses, a whole street plaza with wood, jump ramps everywhere, railroad ties, and some janky vertical half pipe that everybody was scared to skate. It was all kinked as hell. And I just worked full time right after I got out of high school. And all types of lame jobs, dishwasher, busboy. Like, hell no, this sucks. Finally got into concrete in my early 20s. Learn some skills.
Mark Hubbard went by the name Mank, McCardle, Jojo, Marty, and the one that stuck was Monk. But he had a lot of nicknames.
That's where he became the Monk, at the turf. Smiley shaved his head like that so they could buy fucking booze. Walking into liquor stores claiming he's 38. It worked.
Yeah! What's that? So I met Mark Hubbard when I was like 15 or 16 years old, staying at a buddy's house. Buddy Nichols and Dave Rogers, a lot of people know. And they were talking about, oh, Monk this, Monk that. I was like, Monk? Who the hell's Monk? And he's like, oh, redneck, you gotta meet this guy. You'll be like looking in the mirror. I'm like, what? Shut up, whatever, I don't know what you're talking about. So then I met this kid, like my age. I looked at him like, damn, this guy's dirty, kind of hesh.
Both super creative, both super motivated, both super talented. When I met him when he was 17, he was drawing plans for concrete parks, dream parks, MC Escher style. up is down and down is up. And
Mark was a character, man. You can only see the real Mark if you like knew him for 10 or 20 years, you know? Otherwise, he was just kind of this guy that was kind of to himself.
I'm Mark Hubbard from West Seattle. Live at the Bowls for 10 years. And helping in that Oregon project has changed my life forever. Amen.
Business, you got business shades on right there.
You're talking business.
Yeah, well. Lincoln City, power spot on the planet.
Rip Ride Rally, I believe it to be a gathering of just savage concrete enthusiasts.
It's basically you got a bunch of Hellraisers coming out to skate some concrete together.
Twenty years ago, here in Lincoln City, Red and Hubbard, they built this. This was their first paid job. And now 20 years later, everyone's coming back for a big skate jam weekend. You could kind of call this a Woodstock for skaters or a Burning Man for Heshers. The people who skate this stuff tend to be on the fanatical side.
I'm predicting a lot of mohawks, a lot of scars, probably some missing teeth type people. Brutes, man. Brutes that want to see action.
I'm trying to...
You stoked?
It's going to be pure savagery.
It might get kind of gnarly, but think about who runs this event. This is Mark and Danyel Scott. I'm pretty sure they can handle it.
I think we're almost done. It's the finishing touches, right, Lee? We're gonna elevate the judges on that turn so they can see in this, the old part. Everybody's here together to celebrate Lincoln City for 20 years, and I think a lot of things that have happened that have shook our family and the skate park community and skateboarding community, and just celebrating life, getting everybody together and realizing we're all family. I'm hoping that everybody's just coming together in happiness and good times and memories, and this is a special place for everybody, I think.
Just this snake run alone, like this came out of his brain and he eyeballed it, and that looks like it'll work. And this is one of my favorite things to ride ever. He's shocking. He loves to just shock you.
Get that!
His skate parks prove that.
We just got here like 2 minutes ago.
What's your first impressions?
It's fucking big. Gnarly.
My pants is dead now.
Let's see.
My dad is fucking dead, and I changed my underwear because that was too open.
You guys just want to start filling the coolers full of drinks?
We got some granola bars, cookies, whatever.
Love you.
So good to see you.
We got a lot of guys coming out of the woodwork for this. This should be exciting, you know? Like, maybe some no-name guy will win it. Who knows, you know? I'm proud to be doing it for Indy. Which hat is that? Wait. Let me see here. There we go. Yeah, independent trucks! Yeah. Ready for this?
Yeah.
Hey, I got a sticker for you need. Yeah, that's the boys right there. My fallen guys, P-Stone, Jake, Monk, I've known those guys 25, 30, so many stories, all of them, and the fact that they're not here, it breaks my heart, you know, but that's life. We all know that your number can come at any time, and enjoy the moments while you got them, good friends, good times, and I just trip when younger guys than me pass away. I'm like, damn, when is my time? I'm pushing it pretty hard, going strong, and somehow I'm still here, so I don't know, maybe it's the alcohol kills all the bugs or whatever, I don't know what it is, all the diseases.
wouldn't say too fast, but every time I get here, I always like slow myself down when I go down it. I always like kind of get the jitter leg.
We didn't know it was a contest at first. Yeah, I read it was a skate gathering.
And the dog.
I was really here to skate with that dog.
It's on the road. I bought him for $1.75 at Walmart. Well, he was for free, but I had $1.75 in my pocket, and that's what I gave him. Yeah. Been on the road ever since. Road dog.
It's going to be huge. We've got a tournament going here also, baseball tournament, so it's going to be a pretty busy weekend for sure. But people are showing up. It's going to be a heck of a party. It brings a lot of people, and that's we're in tourist town. And we're not the police. We just work for the parks. So, you know. But, you know, you guys got dibs on the parking lot, so that's kind of how it works.
Oh, the parking lot's lit!
I have a paw, you know what I mean? I'm a cat. It's actually science. I learned this from P-Stone himself. Spin it, all the shit from the outside goes to the inside. 55 seconds, you got ice cold beer. Cat's paw.
Oh, you got the fun White Claws?
When your stomach gives up, you don't. White Claw Rolaids, thank you for all you've done for me. Yeah!
I got the permit.
Good morning.
Hi. What's up? We're talking parking.
Yep, I have it allotted in our permits.
So my thing, what I was asking for is in the permit. I want to see what it says because I know I'm going to get like 100 calls from them today.
Sure.
So I just want to make sure that.
No, please. We would like to run this as smoothly as possible.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
And this was supposed to be last weekend. That's why we chose this weekend.
This is the only other thing that people are talking on the mic as hard as it is. Mm-hmm. As much as possible, refrain from dropping random F bombs.
Oh shit, watch your head over there. Oh. All right, let's start this shit. Musica.
All right, those PBRs should be kicking in right about now.
High air, best trick, what you got?
Little car, little Melbourne, Australia.
What I remember of Red and Monk, you know, meeting and becoming this sort of creative force was when they were living together in this little apartment in Portland, scheming and dreaming up, you know, plans for Burnside. Monk had been talking about building something under a bridge, concrete thing under a bridge for a couple years. It was a thing that, like, when it was raining and you couldn't skate the vert ramp in Seattle, you drove around and you looked for possible places to build.
Schmitz Park, rebarred up under this bridge. Bags of fucking concrete about to pour, they got shut down. Nope, let's keep going, find another spot.
Well, as soon as anything started, you know, you're on a fucking train down to Portland immediately.
We started taking the freight trains around the country
and we start going down to Portland and meeting those guys. We started building that stuff under Burnside Bridge. It never really occurred to us that this was going to be our thing. It just was something that we did to have a place to skate.
They were calling it a skate park when it was a parking lot with two little ramps against the wall. And they were, Burnside Park. It's a fucking parking lot.
All I did was just hang out under the bridge like full time and be calling the leftover concrete plant every day. If you have any leftovers, hey, we're here, we're ready. Bring it. Finally, the dispatcher gets sick and we call him and he just ship it. Like, whoa, there's like two trucks lined up. It's a hot old mud. Like, whoa.
There had not been a new concrete skate park built probably since 1979.
Well, Burnside created the skate park boom. That's obvious. I mean, because at that point, 1990, all the 70s parks had closed down because of liabilities.
I mean, it was beyond revolutionary. It was just like, came so far out of left field. It was nuts. I mean, at the beginning, it was a lot of cooks in the kitchen. But, you know, pretty quickly, it came to be Red's project. I think Red was putting in the time and the energy, and I think who can keep up? Early 90s, Red and Monk's relationship, in my memory, was sort of like that competitive, creative, wanting to work harder than the other guy so that you weren't the guy slacking. And they push each other, you know? It's that thing of like...
We got this first little mini bowl done, and Red was like, I want to put pool coping on it. And I was like, I know how to do pool coping. Went in there and I like put in the pool coping on the bowl, and I was like so hyped.
Basically, just pour, more. It took a few years to understand, like, if you have money, you can do it the right way. But, you know, if you're on a budget, you're going to do it the wrong way. But even the wrong way, it turns out more organic and raw and rad, you know. You can skate anything. You just got to get used to it. That's what we did. Yeah! Just shredding, man. The more we built, the more rad it was, and like the more people came. It's magic.
I remember when it gets in Thrasher, you know, and it's on the map, you're like, wow, Portland hasn't been in Thrasher ever.
What's the gnarliest place you ever skated?
Gotta be Burnside.
There's a story up there. There's guys that built their own skate park and they're ripping it as hard as anybody. You know, it's like fucking Woodstock or something, you know? There's a place where people are making it happen. You get there no matter how, if you're down and into it, you fucking go. Think about it, dude. You watch that old footage. There's nothing fucking cooler than taking over by force a plot of land in the middle of a city and fucking making it your own. I mean, it's fucking punk as shit.
And it was pretty much the only thing where you could go. You didn't have to have pads. You didn't have to have money to pay. You just went to this place and skateboarded.
It brought the baggy pants, small wheels kids in. It brought the skate trogs in from the vert ramps. Everyone skated together. At that time, when skating was going like this, vert trogs here, everyone else coming up here. Totally divided. Portland, that never happened. Tranny can be something else than the swing set. Transition can be fucking push it, kick it, you know, hitting this thing that's 4 feet tall and then this thing that's 12 feet tall and everything in between. And it can be super inclusive and everybody can ride and it's not in someone's backyard and you have to know. You didn't have to know anybody to go to Burnside. It fucking helped.
There was workers and there was lurkers. That's about it.
Thank you.
to thank everyone for coming out to Lincoln City. Don't see this every day. Beautiful weather, beautiful weather. Whatever baseball team's playing over there, I hope you lose. We skate, we don't got no coach. Come to the dark side.
Oh, you're the Burnside dude, Burnside dude. I cleaned up down there for 10 years, man. I'm a janitor. I was a janitor there for a while.
Could carry their boards in this area instead of skating down. Smoking of any kind is not allowed. Drinking of any kind is not allowed. And if they see it, they're not going to ticket people. They're just going to shut the entire event down.
Trustful.
I've had three cop tours. I'm on speed dial. Still have some clueless people, but I think it'll be a good time and some good skating today.
Shred, soak, sunshine.
Good shit.
Nothing better, man. You already know.
Drove all the way from Michigan.
Yeah, dude. Yep.
What?
Yeah.
Drove from Michigan and came from Fort Wayne.
Hopped in a van, been sleeping in it. Come out here.
This is first time out west, so I'm chilling, man. It's been
boobs.
Fun.
Fucking boobs.
I can give you one.
Yeah!
I can give you one.
Yeah. Is there fucking White Claws in here?
Huh?
Is there White Claws?
How's it hanging, Danyel?
My goal is to stay open for one more hour before we get shut down. Small goals. One more hour.
How are we looking? Are
they well, the cops just did another loop, so they're right up there. Probably. Just put your sweet self in that van.
I'm gonna go
slam
here.
Slam it. Yeah, sweet.
Oh, background, let's say I'm from Montana. I'm the middle sibling. I have three brothers and three sisters, and probably the loudest, most obnoxious one. I wouldn't say black sheep, but probably the rebel, yeah. And I do all the business administration and PR for Grindland. I'm kind of the conceptual all the way through construction and project managing. My mom was 15 when she had her first daughter. So I was 16 when I had Alexandria, so it wasn't far from that. My mom was married, but.
Danyel was a teen mom when she moved to Lincoln City.
I met some skateboarders that came from Lincoln City to Montana, and they told me what a beautiful, warm place it was. A little deceiving, but. For me, it was just kind of that time. I was just turning 17 and ready to make a change. And by the time I was 18, I came out to Lincoln City and looking for something new and exciting, and I found it.
In the summer of 99, we hear, you know, Red is gone legit. Like, he's actually getting hired to build one of these parks.
You know, Mark was like, wait, what? Somebody wants to pay me to build a park? Like, are you kidding me? Yes.
We had a design on paper, but it got wadded up in my pants. For a while, you know, so it was like, here's the design. I was like, let's do it. It's like, who is this guy, man? Is he nuts?
He brought Mark Hubbard and Sage Bulliard and, you know, the people that had a part of Burnside down. And
Red called me from Lincoln City, and this was 1999. And he's like, yeah, come on down. The Lincoln City wants a park on the coast. And I was like, oh, awesome. And I quit my job to go down there and work with them building that park.
We hear that Monk's coming down and they're going to do it together. So fucking stoked for Red and Hubbard. That's dream shit.
These two dudes came together as a concrete power duo. You got Red is just a brute, put it on his back, just construction lord. And then you got Hubbard, who is looking through a different lens as an artist.
The aliens came down here and mated with the octopus. That's what we are. Look at these tentacles. I'm serious.
With that combo, the rest was history.
And then there's a pretty classic hybrid in here. That one right there.
The two Marks were pretty much the only guys that knew how to somewhat do concrete. Like, the techniques were still being developed.
It was a dream come true. Like, we weren't making hardly any money, but we were doing what we wanted.
Started building and didn't stop.
He had us bend part of the coping up there, ghetto style. Like, he shoved the pole in some rocks and had us bend it. And he was eyeing it up like, that looks good. Like, what's he doing? He grabbed the pipe and placed it right where, you know, the, one of the curves is in the shallow end. Fit perfect.
As soon as we put up the coping in that bowl, it was like, all right, this is on. There wasn't a clear plan for the upper part. We'd put something up and look across from it, but well, we're gonna have to put something here. It's all built by skaters, which is the most important part. Just kind of evolved into its own beast, and you can't really do that anymore. Everything's gotta be site plan, approved, engineered.
But back then, when it was simple and like open template, that's like the best case scenario. Whenever we changed things every day, we'd bring it up to the owner and go, oh, sounds good.
They just let us do whatever we want because they know we're into this for the right reasons. They know we got passion behind it. They know that we want it. So they're just like, go get them.
It was neat to see these excited kids that had found this, like when you're searching for a unicorn or something, and they're out on the job site and these guys are just lined up on the sidewalk watching him, and Tavita and Jeff were like, yeah, that's him. And I was like, that guy, that's the one that you guys are all excited about?
Oh yeah, this hot chick. I'm like, whoa. I was like, pointed at her, I was like, and she's like, flipped me off. I was like, whoa, that's, she likes me.
He was like at my work and waiting for me and having dinner, and he would be sitting there and order this like really expensive steak that I knew cost a lot of money and a Jack and Coke, and he'd be sitting there just covered all dirty, and the waitresses and bartenders would be like, that guy's here again, should we call security? And I was like, no, don't call security, super nice. I'm like, ah, he's pretty shady. And he'd just be sitting there waiting for me until I got off work. And
she's like, there's something I gotta tell you. I'm like, huh? She's like, I got a 4-year-old daughter. I'm like, I got a 4-year-old daughter. Cool, let's party.
It looks weird through here.
You know, Red was at peak crazy at that time. You know, Red was at peak redness in 99.
Beer was the fuel. There was a lot of beer that was put in the concrete, so that's part of the mix. Before Red settled down, I would compare him to a chimpanzee in the zoo. Or not in the zoo, in the wild. He wasn't caged. He was free.
Red used a lot more grunts back then. A lot less like vocalization, more grunts and animal noises. Was not afraid of germs, for sure. For fun and just for shock value, he'd go to the bathroom and he'd come out with a urinal cake in his mouth. Just for show. vehicles, motorcycles, trucks, got pretty dodgy.
Oh my. It's the first time I've ever met a guy that challenged me, and I think he felt the same. I flipped him off, and he's been around ever since. Monk, he was the best man. He took it seriously, and if I could find a person other than myself that Mark finds himself the closest to, it would be Mark for sure.
I don't know where I'd be without her. I'd probably be 6 feet under.
We found out we were pregnant with Mad just shortly after that.
And that next thing you know, you had a kid, now he's going to college. What happened?
Once it was done, this was the biggest, smoothest skate park that any of us had ever seen. And anyone who cared about that stuff, you got there. Next thing you know, boom, Felfer puts Red on the cover.
I got the mag, I saw it, it's Red on the cover, come on.
Gnarliest skate park in America.
We just came home and we were like, oh wow, we built the gnarliest skate park in America. You know, cool. Flying through the air, Red brushing camo.
Come on now, Red camo, you don't see those every day. I gotta go get them. I got a stain on my shirt right now, fashion.
So what's next after Lincoln City?
Today, Lincoln City. Tomorrow, the world. No, we're gonna put a little, you know, company together and hopefully start traveling around and building skate parks all over.
And then all of a sudden the phone rang again, like about 3 months later. It was like, we got another park. And I was like, really?
They finish Lincoln City, then it's off to the races. You know, they become a skate park building company. Grindland. At that point, it's Red is the head honcho. I'm sure Monk is right there with him. You know, they do Newburgh, which at that point I think was the biggest skate park in the world.
The Grand Canyon skate park.
At Newburgh, we kind of figured it out. We're like, you know, I think this is gonna blow up, because people were really digging what we were doing.
We built Redmond and Donald with that same Lincoln City crew that we had kind of evolved with. Very grassroots, I mean, by the seat of our pants, you know, moving our kids from house to house.
We built like 5 parks down in Oregon, and those were all the parks to go to.
What would you guys do to get on each other's nerves?
Bail out on a project with 5 days notice.
In the summer of 2001, they get the chance to go to Austria to build the massive cradle park, Brexleg. Monk, at that time, has the opportunity to stay back in Seattle.
Mark was going with us, and 2 days before we were supposed to leave, he called Mark and was like, I can't do it. And we're like, what the hell do you mean you can't do it?
Pretty much everyone on the crew that was at Lincoln City was lining up jobs. You know, I'm talking to Mark and I'm like, yeah, we got a job coming up in on Orcas Island. He's like, yeah, well, we already got a job going on down here. And I'm like, well, let's do them both. He's like, well, you know, we don't have enough people to do both. And I'm like, well, I got some people. And it just kind of blew up from out of necessity where we couldn't control all the work coming in.
The Seattle skate scene was starting out, and he was like, I can't give up an opportunity to be building in my hometown to go overseas. And so that was the first park that Mark decided to do his own thing.
Now there's too much awesome to keep in one place. You know, they gotta split up. Red keeps Dreamland, and Hubbard goes Grindline and we start doubling parks.
We went from one company to two companies. And when Grindline actually started, we had four guys. We went from doing one park at a time to two parks at a time. All of a sudden, we kind of got catapulted into a real business.
Basically, there was the best of both worlds. There was more parks to be made. You got Grindline, you got Dreamland. These guys are building parks all over the world. Not just parks, the best parks.
It's kind of a competition between the different companies of who's gonna build the best park. And
it became competition. It wasn't a bad competition. Competition was healthy because at that time we didn't have any in our eyes.
These were gnarly guys slinging concrete under the bridge. And then the next thing you know, they have these thriving businesses, and then they start to have families. This is a radical transformation.
Yeah, they've come a long way. You got Hubbard up in Seattle, beautiful family. He's got his own vert ramp. He has Grindline the band. Hubs like to connect the dots, you know, like he wanted to connect the dots all over the states, you know, so you could drive an hour and end up at another Grindline or Dreamland and keep going and just continue. And then all across the planet.
They just went from town to town, building one amazing skate park after another, each one bigger, wilder than anyone had ever seen. These parks, they changed the skateboarding landscape around the world. Kids who would never pick up a skateboard, next thing you know, they're totally ripping. This is where you meet your best friends. It's like home base for the skate scene. And they did this over and over and over again. Thanks to their efforts, there's more skate parks now than there ever were in the 70s and 80s. And following the Burnside model, they're all free. You gotta understand that the style of skating that Red and Monk were doing, this raw transition skating, this was kind of dying out. These guys reintroduced this part of skating to a whole generation. And since these skate parks appeared, the level of skating has gone sky high.
Welcome to Lincoln City, Oregon, baby. We're nothing but good vibes and love, baby. Fuck yeah. Shit.
Stuff like this our whole life. Just skating, skating, skating.
I love that I can
all
meet
I wanted
pros
to.
And like it's actually really cool.
How old are you guys?
I'm 12, he's 12 and he's 10. When I'm like 130 or whatever, I'm gonna have a skateboard either on my feet or in my arms
wall.
When I die.
Yeah.
I mean, it's definitely been a tragic couple of years. First, we lost P-Stone. He was a famous videographer and a beloved member of the skateboard family. That one definitely hit us hard.
P-Stone!
More recently, Jake Phelps passed away, the iconic editor of Thrasher Magazine. And a dear friend. And of course, most conspicuously absent this weekend is Mark Hubbard, Monk, who passed away in 2018. We're really missing these guys, and this event's kind of acting as a memorial. The emotions are running high. Everybody's really hurting.
Myanmar called me on the phone and was really shook up, and I couldn't tell if he was injured, and he always says, "I'm sorry." And a sound in his voice, it was a little different than when he was injured.
I was working somewhere. It's horrible. I was like, "What? You gotta be joking me." I was just like shocked. I think anybody is with death.
I think stunned.
Took everybody for surprise.
I've never seen him like that. It was, I couldn't tell if my heart was broken more seeing and hearing it in Mark or, you know, just leaving somebody behind.
Dude, when you find out somebody like that passes away, I mean, he's got three kids and a wife. You know, that's all you worry, wonder about, you know, is how is it affecting them? You know, the selfish shit comes later.
You know. Marty did it all, man. He had everything. He had the rock and roll band, the mega ramp. His wife, Jenny's like the nicest human being in the world. His kids are amazing. He had too much, man. He's winning too hard. He's gone.
When I was two, so I was around, but I don't remember it. And it's always weird to be back. We've never been here without him, you know, so it's hard to be here without him. Yeah, I was really nervous, and I was just a lot of energy. But I feel like he'd want us to have a good time. I feel really lucky to be around such amazing people who knew my dad so well and who have so much love for him. And it's not over. They built something, and I'm sorry. Just that it keeps going, because you know, concrete fucking lasts. Like, that's how it goes.
Party started with some Grindline. Kaya Hubbard.
it's the toll, you know, it's the tax of fucking life. If you're gonna honor somebody as big a personality and as cool and as impactful as Monk, don't ever say that you're bored. If you are bored, immediately start doing something. Scheme, come up with ways to make your dreams come true. If you know something, teach it. Do anything other than say you're bored.
The way Mark Hubbard lived his life, he was all in. He was a thrill seeker and a risk taker. But more importantly, he was a man who made things happen. He brought people together and left the world a better place.
Hubbard would want us to be doing nothing different. Gathered up, fired up, urethane's running hot, trucks are being melted, and there's fucking music in the air. Plain and simple. I think we nailed it. I know we did.
Event number one, and it's good for the kids. Good clean fun. Kudos to you guys, very well done.
Minus that.
Thank you, Beth. Bye bye, guys.
Yeah, you're welcome. Thank you so much.
Getting ready to make a leap.
everybody, for coming. Rest in peace, Mark Hubbard. Be there for your good friends, family. Stay tight. You know what I'm talking about. I love you all. Now get the fuck off my property. Yeah.